Radioactive decay or nuclear radioactive disintegration is kind of a nuclear process in which a nucleus suddenly emits a particle or a photon without any external excitation. It happens spontaneously on its own. So these kind of nuclear decay processes that happen automatically can be classified broadly into three types: alpha decay, beta decay, and gamma decay. So alpha decay involves emission of alpha particles, which have very low penetrative power. They can penetrate through few sheets of paper. Beta decay involves emission of beta particles, which can penetrate through few centimeters in aluminium. While on the other hand, you have gamma photons, which has the highest penetrative power, and it can penetrate through few centimeters in lead. If you put these three kinds of particles in the presence of an electric or magnetic field, you will find that the gamma photons experience no deviation in their trajectories, suggesting that they are uncharged in nature, while the alpha particles and beta particles will experience deviation in the presence of an electric field, suggesting that they are charged in nature. Now, in this video, I want to discuss in detail these three different radioactive decay processes. I want to talk about what they are, how they happen, and why they happen in the first place. Why is it that a nucleus suddenly decides to emit an alpha particle or a beta particle? What is it that provokes a nucleus to spontaneously emit a photon or an alpha particle on its own? What does it do? How does it happen? So let's begin. First of all, let's take the example of an alpha decay process. So the alpha decay process is very simple. So the alpha particle basically involves a helium nuclei. A helium nuclei consists of two protons and two neutrons. So together it has four nucleon particles. So whenever a nucleus, usually a larger size nucleus having mass number usually greater than 210, is unstable because of its size, then it suddenly emits an alpha particle or a helium nuclei. If you look at the reaction, the alpha particle has mass number 4 and atomic number 2. So because of this reason, the parent nuclei, once it becomes a daughter nuclei, will have mass number A-4 and atomic number Z-2. Whatever energy is released in this kind of a nuclear reaction purely happens because of a result of the mass defect involved in this kind of a nuclear reaction. So if you calculate the mass of the daughter nuclei and the alpha particle, and you calculate the mass of the parent nuclei, you will find the mass of the parent nuclei is greater. So the mass defect involved between the left-hand side and the right-hand side is emitted in the form of energy, which is mostly given off as kinetic energy of the alpha particle. Alpha decays usually happen, as I said, for large size nuclei or nuclei having mass number greater than 210. Why is it so? Why does an alpha decay happen in the first place? So to understand why alpha decay occurs, we need to know about the nature of the nuclear force. So the nucleus is held together by the nuclear force. However, there is another force that exists within the nucleus, and that is the Coulombic repulsion. So the Coulombic repulsion usually exists between proton-proton pairs, and it is trying to break apart the nucleus, while the nuclear force is an attractive force that is existing between both protons and neutrons, and it is trying to hold the nucleus together. The nuclear force is much more powerful compared to the Coulombic repulsion, but only at short distances. So the nuclear force is the strongest in distances of around 1 femtometers to 3 femtometers. So whenever you have a nucleus which is small in size or mid-range in size, in those cases the nucleons are attracted to its nearest neighbors via the nuclear force, and it easily dominates over the Coulombic repulsion. This is the reason that we do not see alpha decay processes in small or medium-sized nuclei. However, as you keep on adding nucleons inside the nucleus, and as the nuclear size becomes larger and larger, a very interesting thing happens. Now, if you look at the Coulombic repulsion, they can exist between two nearest neighboring protons, as well as it can exist between two protons on the extreme ends of a nucleus, because Coulombic repulsion has a range of infinity. It can exist from zero up to infinity. However, as I just now told you, nuclear forces are the most dominant only in ranges of distances from around 1 femtometers to 3 femtometers. So whenever you have a nucleon, it is attracted via nuclear force only with its nearest neighboring nucleons. So when you look at a large size nucleus, the nuclear force exists locally, gluing all the nucleons together with its nearest neighboring nucleons. However, when the size of the nucleus becomes too large, these local nuclear forces, which is holding the nearest neighboring nucleons together, and as a result holding the entire nucleus together, is unable to dominate over the Coulombic repulsion, which now becomes larger and larger because of the increasing number of protons. So a particular size limit is reached beyond which, if the size of the nucleus grows, then the Coulombic repulsion automatically dominates over the nuclear force and tries to break apart the nucleus. This is also the reason why you do not see an infinite number of elements in our universe. You only see around 100 or 110 sort of a stable elemental structures or stable nuclear configurations in the periodic table. You do not see stable nuclear configurations having 200 atomic number. Why is it that? Because that sort of a size of a nucleus which is stable is not possible, because the Coulombic repulsion dominates over the nuclear force in those distances, while the nuclear force dominates over Coulombic repulsion in shorter distances. This is the reason why alpha decay happened in the first place. Whenever nuclear sizes becomes larger and larger, they become more and more unstable. And the only way to become stable is to decrease its size. So whenever a large nucleus is unstable and it wants to become stable, it automatically tends to decrease its size by releasing some of the excess neutrons and protons, which comes off in the form of alpha decay. So alpha decay helps a large size nucleus, which is unstable, to become stable by decreasing its size by releasing an alpha particle in this process. Now, there is another very interesting aspect associated with alpha decay, and that is related to the tunneling behavior. To understand, let's look at this nuclear potential diagram. So inside the nucleus, you have some kind of a nuclear potential well in which all the neutrons and protons are existing in. For our cases, we will take a very simplistic example of a square potential well. But beyond the nuclear walls, you have a Coulombic sort of a potential well which falls via 1 by r, because if the alpha particle has charge of 2, the nucleus also has charge of z minus 2, and it experiences Coulombic energy which varies according to 1 by r. Now, if you look at the nuclear potential well, which consists of the nuclear potential within the wall as well as the Coulombic potential outside its walls, you will realize that for larger size nuclei, the nuclear potential well has a peak of around 20 to 25 mega electron volt. Now, if you remember, I just now told you that the alpha particles that are emitted in most nuclear decay reactions have energies of the order of around 4 to 10 mega electron volt. So how is it possible that an alpha particle which may have an energy of around 10 mega electron volt come out of a nuclear potential which has a height of around 25 mega electron volt? The nuclear potential has a barrier height of around 2.5 times greater than the kinetic energy of the alpha particle. How is it possible? It's not possible classically. It's only possible because of quantum tunneling. Now, to give a brief summary, the quantum tunneling is a phenomena in which any particle which is facing a barrier in which the barrier height has a potential energy greater than the kinetic energy of the incident particle, in those cases, classically, the particle can never penetrate through the barrier, but quantum mechanically, the particle has a very small probability of penetrating through that barrier, even if the barrier has a potential height greater than the kinetic energy of the incident particle. This is because particles are not purely particles, they also have a wave mechanical behavior of their own. And when you solve the Schrodinger's equation for any kind of a wave mechanical behavior, you will find that particles have a certain probability of penetrating through a potential barrier having a height greater than its kinetic energy. This is, in essence, why an alpha decay process, or how an alpha decay process happens in the first place, because of quantum tunneling. This kind of an idea was first stated by George Gamow in his what is known as the Gamow's theory of alpha decay. So in Gamow's theory of alpha decay, what happens is that it is assumed that the alpha particle exists independently inside the nuclear walls within the nuclear potential well. However, the alpha particle inside the nucleus is constantly moving and it is colliding constantly with the nuclear wall. And every time the alpha particle constantly collides with the nuclear wall, it has a certain probability of penetrating through the nuclear potential barrier, even if the nuclear potential barrier is almost 2.5 times greater than a maximum energy that an alpha particle can possess. And it is because of this reason that whenever such a kind of tunneling happens, you see an alpha decay process. This is also the reason why radioactivity in general is a probabilistic phenomena. It is not deterministic in nature. It is a probabilistic phenomena, because if you have one nucleus in your hand, you will not be able to predict whether or not that one nucleus is going to undergo radioactive decay in the next 1 hour. But if you had 100 nuclei in a given plate, you might be able to say that maybe 40 or 30 out of those 100 will undergo radioactive decay processes in the next 1 hour. This is because radioactivity, in a sense, is not a deterministic phenomena. It is a probabilistic phenomena, and it is probabilistic because it comes as a result of quantum tunneling, and quantum tunneling is inherently probabilistic in nature. If you're interested in the Gamow's theory of alpha decay, I'll make one further video in which I'll talk in detail about the Gamow's theory of alpha decay, and I'll also do the derivations associated with the quantum mechanical behavior of the alpha particle inside the nucleus. That's it for the alpha particle portion. Let's move on to the next topic, which is beta decay. Now, as I already told you, alpha particle decay only happens for large size nucleus. On the other hand, you have beta decay, which can happen for small size nucleus, medium size nucleus. It can also happen for large size nucleus. It has nothing to do with the size of the nucleus. What it has to do with instead is the number of protons and the number of neutrons. Now, inside a nucleus, you have two kinds of particles, neutrons and protons. And usually it is seen that almost all kinds of nuclei that exist in nature has a certain neutron to proton ratio. You cannot have, let's suppose, a nuclei having 100 nucleons or mass number 100, but 99 out of them are protons and there is only one neutron. That's not possible at all. That's not going to happen, because it is seen that usually in nature, 50-50 ratio of neutron and proton is favored. Or rather, the ratio of neutrons and protons which is favored is given by what is known as the NZ graph. So the NZ graph basically shows you the kinds of nuclear configurations that exist in nature. So in between the NZ graph, the line that passes through is known as the stability curve. So the stability curve basically represents those nuclear configurations in which the number of neutrons and number of protons leads to the most stable nuclear configurations. For smaller nuclear configurations, the number of neutrons and protons corresponding to stable nuclei are 50-50. But for larger, mid-range to larger nuclei, the number of neutrons starts exceeding a little bit compared to the number of protons. Now, I'll come back to this point in a moment. Let's suffice it to say that the number of neutrons and protons in most nuclear configurations are almost equal, or it varies from around 50% to 60%. Whenever you have nuclei which has an excess number of protons or an excess number of neutrons, and by that I mean those nuclei which do not fall in the stability curve but rather fall either below or above the stability curve, in those cases, those nuclear configurations are unstable. And the only way they can become stable is when the excess number of protons will become a neutron, or the excess number of neutrons will become a proton. Now, those kind of nuclear reactions which involve these transformations are known as beta decay reactions. Now, quite simply, let's take an example of a negative beta decay process. I'm going to talk about the different kinds of beta decay processes in just a moment. Let's take this first example, where we have a boron nuclei which undergoes a transformation to become a carbon nuclei. What happens is that inside the boron nucleus, one of the neutrons will suddenly undergo a transformation to become a proton, and now once the proton is formed, it does not remain a boron nuclei anymore. It becomes a carbon nuclei because a carbon has 6 protons. Transformations of this kind, where a neutron becomes a proton or a proton becomes a neutron, are known as beta decay reactions. Now, why does such a kind of a reaction takes place? If you understand why beta decay happens, you will also understand the nature of the NZ graph. Let's get into it. So what happens is that to understand beta decay process, we need to know about nuclear energy diagram. So in the case of atoms, you probably know that in the case of atoms, electrons exist in certain definite energy levels surrounding the atom. So these are known as electron energy levels of an atom or an atomic electronic structure. In the same way, you have nuclear energy levels also. So inside the nucleus, you have large numbers of protons and neutrons, but they also exist in their own energy levels. And since neutrons and protons are fermions, no more than 2 neutrons can exist in one energy level and 2 protons can exist in one energy level. So whenever you have some kind of a nucleus which contains certain number of neutrons and certain number of protons, they will arrange themselves in its ground state into that kind of a configuration where all the number of neutrons and all the number of protons will occupy the necessary number of energy levels. Now, in our example, we have taken the case of boron 12. Now, boron 12 contains 5 protons and 7 neutrons. Obviously, there is an excess of 2 neutrons in the nuclear configuration of boron. Now, if you look at the energy level diagram or the nuclear energy level diagram of boron 12, you will find that the highest occupied neutron, which has the highest energy, has an energy level which is greater than the highest occupied proton energy level. In fact, the highest occupied proton energy level has one vacancy. So this leaves the option of a transformation between a neutron and a proton. Now, what is going to happen if the neutron in the highest occupied neutron energy level suddenly gets converted to a proton? This new proton will now occupy an energy level which is lower than its corresponding neutron energy level. So as you see, the configuration in which a neutron gets converted to a proton has an overall lesser energy compared to the configuration in which there is an excess number of neutron. So even though both these two configurations has the same mass number, it has the same number of particles, one configuration is much more stable compared to the other configuration. This leads to the possibility of beta decay processes, or this leads to the possibility of neutron to proton conversion. So whenever you have nuclear configurations where there is an excess number of neutrons or an excess number of protons, then this excess number of neutrons can get converted to a proton and decrease the overall energy of the entire system. Similarly, if there's an excess number of protons, the highest occupied proton can get converted to a neutron and decrease the overall energy of the entire system and make it more stable. So to summarize, a beta decay process happens whenever either the number of neutrons or the number of protons are in excess, and those kinds of nuclear configurations are unstable, and they become stable when the particle which is in excess gets converted to a particle which has certain vacant energy levels. That kind of a nuclear transformation where a neutron gets converted to a proton or a proton gets converted to a neutron are known as beta decay processes. By this logic, you can also explain the NZ graph. So most of the nuclear configurations that exist in nature usually tend towards those configurations which fall in the stability line, which corresponds to almost equal number of neutrons and protons. If some kind of a nuclei is deviating from this kind of a stability graph, so it is either below or above the stability graph, in those cases, it will undergo beta decay process so that it can come closer towards the stability graph. Now, there is one point that I mentioned a little bit before, is that when you have larger mass size, then a number of neutrons exceeds a little bit compared to the number of protons. Why is it that? It's because of the very reason we talked about initially, the nature of size. Whenever the size of a nucleus increases, the nuclear force starts getting overpowered by the Coulombic repulsion. So whenever you have increasing size of the nucleus, you require more number of neutrons, because protons lead to repulsion, neutrons lead to attraction. So you require more number of neutrons inside the nucleus to sort of balance the Coulombic repulsion. This is also the reason why that whenever you look at the NZ graph, for increasing mass number, the number of neutrons starts exceeding a little bit compared to the number of protons. Now, before we move ahead to the different kinds of beta decay processes that happen, I have not yet mentioned that there is another particle which is also involved in the beta decay process, and it has a kind of a peculiar history associated with it. To understand it, let's look at the energy of the beta particles which are emitted in any given beta decay reaction. It was found that if you look at the kinetic energy of the beta particle which is emitted in a given beta decay reaction, it is not always uniform. If you conduct a series of beta decay reactions, you will find that vast majority of the beta particles, which are the electrons, will have energies lesser than what is expected of them. In fact, this starts to question the fundamental conservation of energy principle itself. Also, whenever you look at the recoil direction of the parent nucleus and the beta particle, they are not always in opposite directions. In fact, they are in such directions so as to violate the conservation of linear momentum principle also. How is it possible? It was not until later when it was suggested that maybe there was some other particle which was also involved in this kind of a beta decay reaction. If some other particle is involved in this kind of a beta decay reaction, then that particle can take the excess energy compared to the energy of the electron, and thus hold on to the conservation of energy principle, and also that can take off some of the momentum corresponding to the electron and thus prevent the violation of conservation of linear momentum principle. This particle was in fact what is known as a neutrino. Now, I'm going to make another video on the neutrino hypothesis and the sort of interesting story behind it, and I'm going to elaborate on it later on. But for the time being, this is it. So a neutrino is also a particle which is involved in the beta decay reaction. Now, there are different kinds of neutrinos, but in our case, we are dealing with the electron neutrinos, or just simply known as neutrinos. Now, the matter version of electron neutrino is just known as electron neutrino or neutrino. And the antimatter version of the electron neutrino is known as anti-neutrino or anti-electron neutrino. Now, in the example that we have taken, the neutron gets converted to proton, but alongside it leads to the emission of a beta particle, which is the electron, and also it leads to the emission of an anti-neutrino. There is another kind of beta decay reactions that is possible, which is the opposite of a transformation between from a neutron to a proton. So in fact, we can have transformations from a proton to a neutron. So these are known as positive beta decay reactions or positron emission. So in the case of positive beta decay reactions, a nucleus which has an excess number of protons will get converted to a new nucleus where the number of protons will be less. So what will happen is that a proton will get converted to a neutron, but in that process, it will lead to the emission of a positron, which is the antimatter version of electron, and also it will emit a neutrino. There is another kind of beta decay process which takes place, which is also known as electron capture. So electron capture is somewhat similar to that of positron emission in the sense that a proton gets converted to a neutron, but the way it happens is a little bit different. So in certain kinds of nuclei where the protons are in excess, the nucleus can absorb a nearby electron from its nearest K shell. So a nucleus which has excess number of protons absorbs a nearby electron from its nearest electron orbit, then in those cases, a proton after absorbing the electron can become a neutron and also lead to the emission of a neutrino. These kind of processes are known as electron capture. Now, once the electron capture happens, there's a vacancy in the electron energy level, which can be further occupied by some other electron in the higher energy level. That will therefore also consequently lead to the emission of an X-ray because of the transition happening in the energy levels of the electrons. So in a way, the positron emission, which emits an anti-electron, and the electron capture which absorbs an electron are sort of opposite to each other in that sense. In the same way, we can also have inverse beta decay processes in which instead of neutrinos being emitted, you have neutrinos being absorbed. So a proton or a neutron can absorb a neutrino or an anti-neutrino to carry forward a beta decay reaction. Such kind of nuclear reactions are known as inverse beta decay reactions. As much as these kind of reactions are so interesting to learn about, let's move ahead to the next nuclear reaction, which is the gamma decay. So gamma decay is quite simple once you understand how it happens. So in the same way that atoms have electronic energy levels, and in these electronic energy levels that atoms have, electrons can transition from one energy level to another. So if an electron jumps from a higher energy level to a lower energy level, then it leads to the emission of energy in the form of a photon, which has energy almost equal to the difference in the energy levels of the electron. Similarly, since nucleons also exist in nuclear energy levels, nuclear transitions in energy levels are also possible. So what will happen if you have an excited nucleus where the nucleons are not in its ground state, but rather there are a few nucleons which are in an excited state, and that nucleon jumps from a higher energy level to a lower energy level? A similar kind of a process. The excess amount of energy corresponding to the difference in the energy levels will get emitted in the form of a photon. Now, as opposed to electron energy levels, which are very less, they are of the order of few electron volts. Nuclear energy levels are quite energetic. They are of the order of few mega electron volts. So whenever nuclear energy level transitions takes place, the differences in energy is of the order of few mega electron volt. So such transitions lead to the emission of gamma particles, which are quite energetic. So if you have a nucleus which is in an excited state, by excited state I mean the nucleons are not in its ground state configuration. Some of the nucleons might be in a higher excited state configuration. So such kind of an excited state nucleus might become a stable version of itself if one of the nucleons will jump from higher excited state to a lower excited state, and it leads to the emission of a gamma photon. This is known as gamma decay, but gamma decay is not the only nuclear process which is associated with nuclear energy transitions. There are two other processes which are associated with nuclear energy level transitions. One of them is known as internal conversion. So internal conversion happens whenever the energy which is emitted by a nucleus due to some nuclear energy transition is not emitted in the form of a photon, but rather it is absorbed by a nearest neighboring electron. So an electron in the nearest neighboring orbit of the nucleus absorbs the energy from the transition of a nucleon, and the electron becomes free from the atomic energy level, and the excess amount of energy is goes off in the form of the kinetic energy of the electron. So when instead of a gamma photon being emitted, the atom as a whole releases an electron, where the electron kinetic energy comes as a result of the nuclear transition of energy levels, then that is known as internal conversion. You can also have processes of internal pair creation. So the internal pair creation happens whenever the excess amount of energy that comes off due to nuclear energy level transition is so high that it can lead to the creation of a pair of an electron and positron. So pair creation is in a way opposite to the pair annihilation. So in annihilation, you have an electron and an anti-electron, which is a positron, coming together to annihilate each other and become pure energy. So the reverse is also possible, when pure energy can become an electron and a positron. So when the energy of the emitted by a nucleus is sufficient enough, then it can lead to the creation of a positron and an electron, if the energy is greater than the rest mass energy of the electron and the positron pair. So that is known as internal pair creation. So that is it for today. In this video, I have tried to condense all the different aspects associated with the different kinds of radioactive decay processes, the alpha decay, the beta decay, and the gamma decay. So I've tried to talk about the what, the how, and the why of these different kinds of nuclear radioactive decay processes. And I hope that you have enjoyed and learned something from the video. That's it for today. Thank you very much.